Dear friends, welcome to Hindu Christian Dialogue Fellowship, a series of online lectures jointly organized by the Ecumenical Christian Center, CBCI Office for Ecumenism and Dialogue, Sri Ramakrishna Mission, and Focal Area Movement. Friends, I'm extremely delighted and fortunate to introduce a dynamic and amazing scholar for this webinar. He'll be our moderator by name, Reverend Father Tom Mangatothale, for this exciting webinar on the theme Sages and Saints of India, Swami Vivekananda. Father Tom is an ordained priest in the Catholic Church. In fact, Father Tom is an amazing missionary and a compassionate leader. Moreover, Father Tom is a visionary who influenced thousands of people with his dedication, integrity, and hardworking. At present, Father Tom is serving as a secretary for ecumenism in and NESCOM, the Northeast Social Communication and Northeast Indian Regional Bishops Council. Father Tom made a groundbreaking research on search for peace in Karbi, Anglong, Assam. When I was collecting data about Father Tom, many friends from Assam, they said that this book is one of the cutting edge and it's a groundbreaking research. Father Tom also closely worked with Baptist, Methodist, Anglicans, and other churches to bring Christian unity through ecumenism. Father Tom also closely worked with the Henry Martin Institute and other reputed international ecumenical organizations. Father Tom has been a light in the darkness. Father Tom is a gifted priest with a massive intelligence. Father, on behalf of all of us, I cordially invite Father Tom Mangatothale to take over and to moderate this amazing and exciting webinar. Over to you, Father Tom.
Thank you, sir. Sukumar for introducing me. I do not deserve all those qualities that you have said. I must thank Father Matthew for inviting me to moderate this session. And then I must also say that it was Father Matthew who introduced me to a lot of webinars. And I learned a lot from ECC online webinars. Sometimes we are online, otherwise we attend later. I must appreciate the commendable work that ECC has done in connecting people in spite of the pandemic from last year onwards. And I have tried to imitate some of the methods that the ECC has been following, especially in the Northeastern region. I am really honored to be present today. And I am. It is an honor again because I am with Swamiji, Swami Dayanatmananda, one of the reputed leaders of our country with a varied experience of Hinduism and humanism. And I was just reading through some of his contributions. And then I must say, I am really humbled to moderate a session or I don't want to use the word moderation, but just to listen to a sage like Swamiji. Swamiji, thank you very much for your time and for your life, your exemplary life in this part of the world, in our country. And by your life, you have shown there is what could be, what is the real life of a Hindu, cutting across the other religions, a wonderful person to interact with. And you rightly said about a new virus. Well, if they come to you, the devotee, you know, casually used, That is, people flock to you, to hear you, to listen to you. Thank you very much, Swamiji, for your time. And we would love to hear from you. And after your presentation, we would open the floor for some questions, some clarifications, and some comments. Over to you, Swamiji. Yes.
So, shall I start?
Yes, yes, Swamiji, please begin.
Okay, excellent. Om Asato Ma Sagamaya Samaso Ma Jyotirgamaya Mrityor Ma Amrutangamaya. Lord, lead us from the unreal to the real. Lead us from ignorance to knowledge. Lead us from death to immortality. Om, peace, peace, peace be unto all. Father Matthew and all of you, those who are present here, I am extremely happy and very grateful for giving me this wonderful opportunity to share some of my thoughts with all of you. Today's our subject is Swami Vivekananda and his contribution to the whole world. As an introduction, many of you know that Hinduism is one of the religions which believes that whenever humanity needs guidance, right understanding, and inspiration, the Divine Lord, who is the creator of the entire universe for the welfare of all, incarnates, manifests in the form of a human being. We call them Avatar Purusha. And he doesn't come only for one particular region or state or country, but for the entire world, not only for a short time, but for millenniums together. As an example, the influence of Sri Rama, influence of Krishna in the form of Bhagavad Gita, in the form of Bhagavatam. Jesus Christ, who was more than 1,000 years back. Buddha, who was even 2,600 years back. Their influence is even today as fresh. And by the way of a definition, if people have got some non-belief in the incarnation, descendants of God, then this is the definition. That person whose life and teachings give inspiration, unites humanity, guides them in the right path, clarifies the goal of life, shows all the possible pathways to manifest their own divinity, and their influence will be for such a long time, millenniums and millenniums, in whom such a power is manifest, that personality will be called, believed in, worshipped as an incarnation of God. So this is the most wonderful news, that all these past incarnations are not dead, but their influence is working even today. But sometimes some people, out of blindness, misinterpret the influence, the true teachings. Teachings, guidance is eternal, but their adaptability for the changing times must be adjusted according to the changing times, circumstances. So we believe that in the 19th century, that God has incarnated in the form of Sri Ramakrishna, and he trained some disciples, and one of the chief of those disciples was Swami Vivekananda. Many people perhaps may not be so familiar with Sri Ramakrishna's life and teachings, but many people are familiar because Swami Vivekananda happened to attend the Parliament of Religions that was held at Chicago in September, 11th September, 1893. So today our topic will be this great soul. What was his contribution? First of all, I said he was a great soul. How do we know that he was a great soul? Hindus always believed that an incarnation always brings certain assistants, helpers with him, because often an incarnation by himself will not be able to spread his mission. The main purpose of an incarnation is to set up a definite goal and give inspiration. That is the most important thing in this world. The current has gone. I don't know how long it is going to give us, but what I want to do, just please give me, excuse me for a minute. Please, some light will be there. As I was saying, just a minute, let me see connections. Hotspot and mobile hotspot. Okay. I hope this will continue for some time. Let us pray to God. What happens after that, we will see. So these Hindus have a belief that incarnations of God, they bring along with them helpers because their bodies are too soft, too unsuited for certain types of missionary work. So for example, Buddha had brought Ananda. Christ's message was spread more by Paul, Saint Paul. And Rama's message was spread by Hanuman. Krishna's message came through the help of Arjuna. So Sri Ramakrishna's message came through the instrumentality of Swami Vivekananda. Hindus believe that Swami Vivekananda was also one of the great rishis. It's a very peculiar belief. God never abandons his creation. So in this world, God has created certain beings as his representatives called, we call in Hinduism, seven rishis. And one after another, they will be looking after the both material and spiritual welfare of the people. Whenever there is any problem, immediately they will send some emergency help. And one such is believed to be Swami Vivekananda. In any case, whether we believe it or not, his life and teaching subsequently, and we can judge after the passing away of more than 100 years, that whatever he had done was most marvelous things. Very briefly, I want to touch about his life. Swamiji, he was familiarly known as Swamiji, even though many Swamis are addressed as Swamiji. And usually, whenever we write Swamiji, it is usually meant as Swami Vivekananda. He was born, his name was Narendranath Datta, and he was born in an affluent family in Kolkata on 12th January 1863. And he was a precocious boy, and he excelled in practically everything, physically, intellectually, morally, aesthetically, spiritually. He was a great man. His memory power was fantastic. If Narendranath hears anything twice, he can remember it for life. So he has grown up in an affluent family, and he had good education, but he paid less attention to academic education though he did pass BA, but his interest was more all round. There was no subject which he was not interested in. Even at the time, he had shown a great greatness. There were many incidents. If you wish, you can go through his life and you will get them. But by the time he graduated from Calcutta University, he had acquired a vast knowledge of different subjects, especially Western philosophy and history. He was born with a yogic temperament. He used to practice meditation even from his boyhood. And he became absorbed whenever he meditated, and he became unconscious of the outside world. He was in search of highest truth, and he joined the Brahmo Samaj. There were certain good things from the Brahmo Samaj he learned, but certainly he came to the conclusion that Brahmo Samaj is not a spiritual organization. It's more of a concerned with more of a social upliftment than anything else. But it has done great good. It has participated in the overall developments of Indian culture and spirituality. Hindus, as I mentioned, always have a strong belief that a great man is always born but never made. Of course, training helps a person manifest his innate greatness, but there must be greatness before birth. A mango seed will always become a mango tree, but a neem seed, an apple seed, is not going to become a mango, sweet mango tree. Mentioning mango because there are very few people who dislike mango. That is the greatest, the queen of all fruits, as we say. It is most wonderful. Okay. Swami Narendranath Datta, he had many difficult situations and he suffered much. He learned much. But by the time he became a young man, he had tremendous longing to know whether God exists, and if God exists, whether there is anyone who had seen God, because he never believed. I say, so you believe. Have you seen God? If you say yes, then I will test you, because the test of God realization is not the affirmation from the mouth of the person, but the character, how he behaves. Four important characteristics are there. The man is always happy. Man is extremely loving everyone. He treats everybody equally. He is prepared to give up his life like Jesus gave up his life for the sake of the world. When we find these kind of effects, they show an effect cannot be without a cause. And these characteristics definitely point a state of mind which we can call as God realization. So he was longing. He met many contemporary spiritual leaders like Devendranath Tagore, Keshav Chandra Sen, etc. But they could never affirm that we have seen, experienced God. They always evaded that direct answer, but encouraged him, seeing his sincerity. Ultimately, somebody pointed him to Sri Ramakrishna, and he came to Sri Ramakrishna. He had about 4.5 years of training under Sri Ramakrishna. The very first question he asked was, "Sir, have you seen God?" And Sri Ramakrishna's typical answer was, "Yes, I have seen God." But then, how will you know that I have not seen God, but I am simply saying I have seen God? Or, I have seen God, but I say I haven't seen God. Is there any way for you to prove that I am a knower of God? This is every Hindu will ask, should ask this question. Simply having blind faith will not do. The only way to understand is, first of all, if anybody has realized God, then these godly spiritual characteristics must be present in that man, because if there is a cause, there must be effect. If there is no effect, it is a foregone conclusion that there is no cause at all. And Swami Vivekananda, future Narendranath Dutta, he observed Ramakrishna was the holiest of the persons among human beings he met. And Narendranath had met many a brilliant person. But Sri Ramakrishna said, the only final proof of God's existence is you must experience God yourself, then only your doubts will go. Faith is good for as a starting point, as a self-starter, but realization is the ultimate thing. A faith must be transformed into a fact, a personal experience. And Sri Ramakrishna trained him, and he started having many spiritual visions, and ultimately he did experience God. Again, as I was telling, we believe in it. It is foolish to say anybody is an incarnation of God or anybody is a God-realized soul. The only proof is when I realize, I know without the least bit of doubt, this person had seen God. God is good. That is the only proof. After the passing away of Sri Ramakrishna on 16th August, in the month of August, another 4 days, 1886, these disciples who were 16, they took a vow on 24th December, Christmas Eve, that they will renounce the world. And then after some time, formally they have taken monastic vows, and Narendranath was given another name. This name Vivekananda came after changing monastic name 2-3 times. The reason was he did not want to be recognized. He wanted to tour India and understand the condition of India incognito. It's only just before his travel to USA to attend the Parliament of Religions that he had taken the name Swami Vivekananda, that is to say the person whose joy is in discriminating. So this Swami Vivekananda, he toured India for several years, and it was not mere spiritual tour, but it was a tour to understand what is the condition of India and is it in good condition? If not, what were the conditions? If so, what were the causes that led to this downfall of India? And most of us are Indians, so we know from history, 19th century was the worst century in the whole history of India, when several forces from outside came and enslaved us and tried to rub out all our native Indian culture and introduce their own foreign culture, which will never work out in any country at any time in history. If at all anybody attempts, it will be a terrible disaster. We can only grow from our own roots, but we should never replace, cut the roots and put some other roots. The result will be a foregone disaster. So he understood India had degenerated physically, mentally, morally, aesthetically, and spiritually. And centuries of oppression by whom? Swami Vivekananda's conclusions are not only dramatic, but they are mind-boggling. By touring and very careful observation, through very careful observation, Swami Vivekananda understood that the root cause of India's downfall was not foreigners, were not Westerners, neither Western religions, but the root cause is firmly rooted in the very practitioners of Hindu religion, especially. They have neglected, they have misunderstood the true meaning of religion, the religion's dimensions, and failed to follow it. They interpreted them in their own way and tried to impose, bringing about terrible degradation on practically 90% of the humanity. This was what had happened. So he understood India was degenerated and that India became weak, and that's why the foreign powers had come. Swamiji had a very apt way of expressing this truth. All around us, all sorts of germs of diseases are present, not that at a particular time they come. For example, this corona was not a new phenomena. Even 50 years back, it was there. Bill Gates had warned us about it. Be careful. If we are not ready, it's going to overwhelm us. And what he spoke so many years back, it became a prophetic truth. Even today, we are not ready for this corona disease. And this is only the beginning. With all our wanted scientific knowledge, nobody could predict that one tiny germ could invade the whole world, make it completely helpless, and bring about tremendous changes, both in the outside as well as inside world of humanity. Even now, are we ready? We are not ready. But I can tell you, if humanity doesn't behave properly according to the teachings of these great sages and saints and incarnations of God, Hinduism accepts every incarnation of God. Because from God's point of view, these are Hindus, these are Muslims, these are Christians. Such a thing doesn't exist. They are all my children. In fact, they are me. So he comes, his teachings are relevant, not for a particular time, for all the time to come. That's what we call the Veda. And this knowledge of God, which is called Apaurushaya, is coming from God, not man-made. But there are some eternal truths. They are not changeable. There is no option there. But they have to be interpreted in practice according to the changing times. That was what one of our past presidents have given talks and books also. Eternal values for a changing society. Values will always be eternal. But we have to adopt those in practical terms according to changing times. And if any religion fails to do that, that religion becomes fanatical, it becomes poisonous, it will, wherever it spreads, it brings about only poison, destruction, oppression, untold suffering. You open your eyes, you will see it even now, right in front of our eyes, it is happening. Swamiji understood the only way to improve India is through education. What is education? It is not merely academic education. It's something much more. He gave a beautiful definition. I'll give two definitions. One definition is this. Education is the manifestation of perfection already in man. He, means Swami Vivekananda, also gave a beautiful definition of religion. It doesn't pertain to Hindu or Christian or Muslim or Sikh or Jain or Baha'i. It applies to every religion, past, present, and future. Religion is the manifestation of divinity already in man. We are all divine because if God creates, he doesn't create us from mud, from filth. He himself is the material cause. He himself also the efficient cause. In other words, he himself manifests as all of us for his own divine purpose called divine leela. So we are all divine. That's why there is a irrepressible, unsuppressible longing for sat, for chit, and for ananda, as made clear in the opening prayer, asato ma sadgamaya. may I never die, may I never be ignorant, may I never be unhappy. We don't think and formulate these desires, these goals. They are instinctual because that's our nature. God is eternal, God is all-knowing, and God is all bliss. So this is what Swami Vivekananda understood. Each soul is potentially divine, and education is that training by which we can gradually, living a righteous life in this world, can bring us our own potential perfection. And when we become perfect, we know that we are part of God, we are inseparable from God, we are God. I and my Father are one, as Jesus Christ puts it. But for that, education, secular education, scientific education, intellectual education, all fields of education have to be given according to the potentialities of it. But the goal of whatever be the field, a musician, a sculptor, a poet, or a scientist, or a manager of a huge company, CEO, these are methods, these are means, these are pathways, but it is to perfect, to manifest their own inner divinity, inner perfection. For that, Swamiji said, the first thing to be done is to give secular education. Education is that which makes a person stand on his or her feet, and which makes that person discriminate, evaluate what is right, what is wrong, what is good, what is evil, and develop the willpower to give up what is non-helpful and accept what is helpful and move forward in the evolutionary scale. And ultimately, that has to be continued until we know I am one with God. This was what he said. But India at that time was in need of great help. And as I said, God doesn't incarnate only for one particular country, one particular religion. It is universal. So fortunately, there was a huge exhibition. I think it is the 400th discovery of America by Columbus. And as an afterthought, religion also had contributed to the culture and spirituality of humanity. So as an afterthought, the organizers convened a huge meeting known as afterwards the Parliament of Religions, that was first supposed to be held in September, but it had to be postponed. And in the month of November, 9/11, that is the exact date on which the Twin Towers were shattered by the fanatical group. So there was Parliament of Religions, and Swami Vivekananda understood, I have a mission, and that it may be an exaggeration, you should forgive me, that Swami Vivekananda felt that Parliament of Religions was actually organized for this sake, for my sake, for my means, not Swami Vivekananda, for the sake of the eternal message of the Vedanta, which is each soul is potentially divine. The goal is to manifest that divinity within, and there are infinite ways. Not only every religion, karma yoga, bhakti yoga, raja yoga, jnana yoga, in fact, anything that unites man with God is the right pathway. Every man has to choose. This liberalism, plurality of religions, is a fact of life which Hinduism preaches, which I have outlined in my first talk on Sri Ramakrishna. As many faiths, so many paths. And Swami Vivekananda, he went there with the help of some people, and then he attended. And then on the first day, he was called upon, but a very short talk he gave without preparation by remembering the goddess of knowledge, Saraswati. And when he uttered five words, sisters and brothers of America, the whole audience of nearly 4,500, the very elite of American people, they all rose spontaneously to applaud him. He became world famous overnight. Then he stayed several years in America. He also visited Europe and many other places. And then finally in 1897, he came back. He was received with the greatest honor. Then on 1st May 1897, he established the Ramakrishna Mission, because he learned in the West that a single individual cannot do. There must be an enduring effort, and that can be done only through an organization. And that organization was alien to Hinduism before that. There were a few organized societies. So he established the Ramakrishna Mission, Ramakrishna Order, in the name of Ramakrishna, a monastic order. And it contains not only monastic members, not only devotees, but even non-devotees who have faith in the ideals of Sri Ramakrishna without professing devotion or even loyalty to Ramakrishna Vivekananda, but they believed in the teachings of Ramakrishna Vivekananda, which are none other than pure Vedantic teachings. And so they help any good organization. And this is how, from that time, Ramakrishna Mission had to struggle a lot. Now we have more than nearly 200 branches in India, including in the Western countries, a few are there. And this purpose of this Ramakrishna Order is twofold: Atmano Mokshartham Jagat Hitayacha, meaning I will use this organization for my own spiritual growth and perfection. At the same time, I must also contribute my share to the welfare of the country. And since that time, the mission has been growing, it is branching out, and it is follows strictly the teachings of Sri Ramakrishna, but as interpreted by Swami Vivekananda, called Neo-Vedanta. In brief, this is the life of Swami Vivekananda. And in 1902 and July 4th, Swami Vivekananda, even before he reached the age of 40, he voluntarily gave up his body, though apparently he was suffering from diabetes and he passed away. But we very strongly believe that he decided to give up the body because he was born to fulfill a mission, and he knew he fulfilled the mission, completed the mission. And as Ramakrishna had predicted, the moment Naren comes to know who he is, and he will come to know who he is only when he had completed the divine mission for which he was born, he will refuse to live a second longer. And that's what had happened. He passed away, but he bequeathed his legacy of this universal Vedantic teachings. And these Vedantic teachings are just few. Anyway, tonight, in the short time that we have, I will outline what were the contributions of Swami Vivekananda. What did he attempt? First of all, he wanted to rouse the religious consciousness of the people, both in India and everywhere he went, and to create in them, in their faith, pride, and that deep belief in their own heritage, in their own religion, in their own culture, whether he be a Christian, a Muslim, a Hindu, or whatever he be. Every religion is a very valid path, as proved by Sri Ramakrishna's own experience. Next, to bring about unification of Hinduism by pointing out the common basis of its sects. Why? Because Hinduism had never become cooperative. One of the greatest defects of Hindus is they never cooperate with each other. So that is why, as I tell jokingly, Mahatma Gandhi wanted to bring about the political freedom of India. He said, all of you cooperate, Hindus with one voice said, no, we will not cooperate. And then Gandhiji changed his phraseology. He said, you must be non-cooperative. And they all said, yes. So that is how, through non-cooperation, the freedom, political freedom of India has come. Even today, India produces greatest intellectuals, brightest brains. They can do a lot. But for the one defect of non-cooperation, jealousy, one Hindu, one Indian, I would say, cannot tolerate other Indian. I'll tell you a small joke. An American journalist came to India. He toured the whole country for about a month. And just before he was embarking to go back to America, an Indian journalist met him and asked him that you have toured the whole of India for a month. Yes. And how many Indians did you meet? He said, none. What? You toured the whole of India? You didn't meet one single Indian? Yes, yes, I met some Bengalis, met some UP Wallahs, I met Tamilians, I met Telugu people, I met Kerala people, I met Hindus, I met Christians, I met Muslims. I did not meet a single Indian. Today, this is the greatest tragedy. Our country is so blessed. All the politicians, to our greatest regret, are only trying to do they selfishly get power and position. Nobody is thinking in terms of the country. And if anybody is thinking some good, then all of them join together, unite, cooperate, oppose, like an organization of thieves. This is the greatest tragedy. So Swami Vivekananda wanted to bring about unification. Hinduism, as many sects, they were quarreling. They said, no need. You follow your own path. Let others follow their path. Every religion, every sect, every faith leads us to the same goal. And then he wanted to draw the attention of the educated people on the plight of the downtrodden masses and to expound his plan for their uplift. And it is not only the Indian students. This had to be done by everybody in this world. That is to say, everywhere, the political leaders, the mafia, the powerful people are oppressing, suppressing the biggest, what you call, global companies. They are cheating their own customers, and they were lining their own pockets, and they wanted to control them, not only physically, but mentally, by creating what many of you know as algorithms. So this is what is going to happen now. We have to keep away. This was what Swamiji wanted to say, that every educated person has his duty, and if he fails, he is the greatest traitor to his religion, to his country. If you do not uplift, try to help the other people, you lead your own life, and you also treat other people also. Very briefly, what was Swami Vivekananda's contributions to world culture? A new understanding of religion. What is that? Religion is not Christianity, not Hinduism, not Islam. Religion is the manifestation of divinity already there in potential form in every living being. But in man, there is a special opportunity. Then a new view of man. What is it? Man is not an animal. He is not to be treated as a worker. He has to be treated with a child of God, a manifestation of divinity. Whatever be the field of work, encourage everybody to become perfect through education, through training, but respect, reverence for every human being. Then only there is hope for humanity. Third, a new principle of morality and ethics. A prevalent morality in both individual and social life is mostly based on fear. Even today, fear of the police, fear of public ridicule, fear of, in religions, God's punishment, fear of karma by Hindus, and so on and so forth. Nobody says, I have to be moral because there is no difference between me and anybody else, living or non-living. Swami Vivekananda made a new understanding of morality. What is morality? I treat everybody as my own self, as I do not wish to suffer and to get injured. I will also try not to give suffering to others or injure the other people. This looking upon everybody as equal to one's own self is the new ideal of morality. Not really, it is not new, but it is a clarification of the obscured lying definition of morality that was there from the very beginning. Fourth, he wanted to build a bridge. No country, no religion can live in isolation, especially when modern science and technology had brought us nearer to each other. In every country, other religions, every religion is present, every culture is present, every nationality is present. They are living in interreligious, intercultural, interlinguistic societies. And if we do not understand, then the tragedy will be, there will be no development for me or for other people. So there is no East or West. Both are there, but they have distinct contributions, distinct culture. If we can take what we lack and if we give what others lack, that is the bridge he wanted to build. But the most important thing is the divinity of man itself. For that, he said, a new ideal of monasticism should be there. And finally, these are the four important contributions of Swamiji for Hindus themselves and for every religion: a new respect for human being, a new idea of morality, and building a beautiful bridge between the East and West. Both are specialized in something. Both can contribute each other. And the law of life is give and take. And that is the only way. I give what I have and I take what I lack. This is the only way to realize the brotherhood of man, which is the dream of every incarnation of God. So Swami Vivekananda's one or two teachings I will quote. My ideal indeed can be put into few words, and that is to preach unto mankind their divinity and how to make it manifest in every moment of life. And education is the means, and education is the manifestation of the perfection already in man. You don't get perfection from outside. You don't borrow it. You don't inculcate it from outside. But whatever seed is there, you develop it. We want that education by which character is formed, strength of mind is increased, the intellect is expanded, by which one can stand on one's own feet. And religion is the manifestation of divinity already in man. This is the gist of all worship: to be pure and to do good to others. It's love and love alone that I preach. And I base my teaching on the great Vedantic truth of the sameness and omnipresence of the soul of the universe. Om. Asato ma satkamaya, tamaso ma jyotirkamaya, mrityor ma amritamaya. O Lord, lead us from the unreal to the real. Lead us from ignorance to illumination. Lead us from death to immortality. May the divine being bless us all with the awakening and recognizing and manifesting our own divinity. Very good. Once again, I thank all of you, especially Father Matthew, for giving this opportunity, and all of you who are contributing your best. Thank you very much. May God bless us all.
Thank you very much, Swami Dayatmanandji. Swamiji, right from the very beginning,
yeah.
You were presenting Swami Vivekananda right from the perspective of avatar, and then how he became a disciple of Ramakrishna, then his teachings, his influence, his contributions.
Yeah,
you were just reading like a book, you know, or seeing a film on an important person. And we really thank you for your wonderful presentation, and then taking us into the deep, the depth of the life of Swami Vivekananda ji, and then the way you presented it, you know, it is not simply an academic exercise or simply saying sharing a bookish knowledge. You spoke from your heart.
Yes.
What does Swami Ramakrishna, what Swami Vivekananda means to you?
Yes.
Was so evident when you were speaking. Thank you so much, Swamiji. Now we will open the floor for a little discussion or some clarifications.
Yes.
And you may use the chat box, or you can just use the reaction button on our Zoom, or you can just unmute yourself and speak. Yes.
Yes, there is a question, but it was half only read. Swami Vivekananda Dude, 39 years, 8 months and a few days, just about 4 months before he reached the age of 40, he gave up his body. That's what. The other half was cut off. Would you kindly, how could
yes.
I see?
Swamiji, it is like this. thank you, Swamiji, for your presentation on Swami Vivekananda. Huh. How many years did Swami Vivekananda live in abroad? What was his chief learning in the West or from the West? Yes.
Okay. He went to America in 1893 to attend the Parliament of Religions. He returned back in the year 1897, so approximately about 4.5 years. Then, second time he went for a few months because he was in a very bad health. So his whole stay in the West, in between he toured Europe also, it's not much less than 6 years. Yes.
This is again a comment, Swamiji. Excellent presentation, Honorable Swamiji. Great insight. Another side of coin, so interesting. Anyway, that is just a comment from our chat box.
Yeah.
Swamiji, I just want to re-ask you the question. What was his chief learning from the West?
Organization. See, the very first addressing of the Parliament of Religion, Sisters and Brothers of America, they were not mere words. He was a man of God realization. He really meant, just as I am divine, all of you are also divine. There were other speakers who addressed sometimes the audience as sisters and brothers, but it was what you call a social response. But when he addressed, unbeknown to them, they all rose to their feet, and they applauded him for 4 or 5 minutes until the president had to beg, please keep maintain silence, because he could uplift people. And we believe, I wholeheartedly believe, when Jesus addressed, you are all children of God, they must have really felt it. But how long they could keep up that spirit is a totally different issue. Reception is there, retaining was not there. So there was nothing spiritual he could learn, but he could see many people were longing for spirituality, but being oppressed by one-sided teachings of their, especially Christianity, But he understood that a single man cannot do anything. An organization was necessary. There was a funny incident. And one day he came excitedly to a hostess with whom he was staying. And he said, Grandma, I fell in love. And she teased him, who is that fortunate lady, Swamiji? You know, Swamiji was a monk. Then he laughed and said, no, that's not a woman, that's not a lady, it's organization. So he understood, even two thieves, will have to join their forces together if both of them want to escape the suffering and become more successful. How much more? That's what is lacking precisely in India today. Complete cooperation, whether it is between political parties or between companies, within the same company, this endemic disease called non-cooperation is ruining India even today, even in monastic organization. I will be a little bit franker, but I have nothing to lose by telling this one. Every organization, non-cooperation, jealousy, competition, and forgetting what the Divine Lord wants to hear to you. Shall I share a joke with you?
Yes, Swamiji.
In Poland, there was a woman who led an immoral life earlier. She became regenerated and she wanted to enter into a church. So one evening, with full of what we call regret for her past life, she was going to enter into a church. But the church authorities knew her thoroughly, so they prevented her. You can't enter, you are a sinner. So several times she requested, but they would not even hear what she was requesting. So with complete disappointment, she turned, and it was semi-dark, something she could see. She was walking down. Suddenly she found someone was walking up and down in that same lane. And when she went near, suddenly she was shocked. It was Jesus Christ himself. She ran to him and said, Lord, Lord, look at this injustice. I really regret the type of life I led. I want to enter into this church, but they are not allowing me to enter. Jesus put his hand on her shoulder and said, my daughter, they are not allowing me also to enter into the church.
Thank you, Swamiji, for the response. If I understand something that Swami Vivekananda learned from the West, is
organization.
Yes, the organization. And he. Yes. Thank you, Swamiji. Yes. Anybody, any other questions we have?
Yeah, Swamiji, thank you very much for your erudite presentation and your life experiences from the Ramakrishna Mission and Swami Vivekananda. There is actually, I was a few times in Chicago, there is a Vivekananda Avenue.
Yes.
That was named after Swami Vivekananda, I think somewhere close to the center where he spoke. Then also another interesting thing is that, you know, before he went to US in 1892, I think he wanted to learn more about Christianity. So therefore, Swami Vivekananda went to the seminary. There was a Catholic seminary. There is a Catholic seminary which is still functioning in Goa, Rashol Seminary. So so when I went there, they showed me a room where, you know, it was the place where Swami Vivekananda stayed, and he was there with them for the Christmas. So just to know more about, yes, and I think last time also I said I had the opportunity to stay for a 2 weeks time in Ramakrishna Mission, Puranattugara. And then learned about all those great monks, how they have deeper knowledge about Christianity and other things. So my question is about, you know, there is also Sister Nivedita. was also a very close associate of Swami Vivekananda. Could you, Swamiji, please enlighten us about the work, Sister Nivedita, how she came to interact with Swami Vivekananda?
Yeah. Sister Nivedita, she was an Irish lady. Her father was a missionary. So, but from the very beginning, she was having much more liberal ideas about Christianity than her father. So she wanted to become a teacher. She got education. She moved to London and she was experimenting with new educational ideas in the 19th century. And when Swami Vivekananda visited London, one person who knew Swami Vivekananda had informed her, a great teacher had come from India and you will be glad. So she met in her friend's house who organized this meeting. And then she said that I fell in love with the teachings of Swami Vivekananda. Then she said, why were you attracted by his personality? Were you attracted because of his person? She said, no. See, I perceived a great quality in him. What was that quality? If I can rationally convince him that what you have been believing and practicing ever since your childhood until now is completely irrational. If I can convince him, then immediately, without the least hesitation, he would give up everything. That means that quality of searching, seeking, and accepting only truth to be found through rational usage of man's faculty. Only that truth, he is open to that truth wherever it was found. And then once he made, after hearing about how Mary wanted to offer herself to Jesus Christ through her heart's blood, then he said that had I been there, I would have poured my heart's blood and washed the feet of Jesus Christ. Not with the fragrant this thing, but real, real heart's blood. And he had the highest regard, because you know, this is what Hindus believe. I believe that Jesus Christ is none other than he only is reborn, or Buddha was reborn as Christ. Christ was reborn as Ramakrishna. And Ramakrishna's teachings, forget about the personalities, the separation of the geographical distance, their families, everything. Compare their teachings. They talked only about God, attainment of God, and nothing else. So this Miss Margaret Noble was her name. She was very much impressed, and every day she attended, and she was influenced. A day has come when she said, Swamiji, how can I be of service to India? And then he said that the greatest need India has is to uplift the woman. And for that, we don't want a man. We want a woman. Only a woman can understand. And you have the heart of a lioness. If you can come, I can tell you, even if you can help Indian women, even if you hate me, I'm adding my own words, even if you give me up, but I will never give you up. Wherever you are, I will uplift you and I will see that you reach God. This is my promise, but you think over it. And then she decided to dedicate her life. That's why she was named by Swamiji as Nivedita. Miss Margaret Noble was given the vows of a brahmacharini. I hope you understand it. I will not marry. I will dedicate my life for the service of India, especially Indian women through education. And so Nivedita means an offering to God. And her whole life, until she passed away, I think in 1911 in Darjeeling, helping Jagadish, Sir Jagadish Chandra Bose, the scientist, and she dedicated her life only for the upliftment of India, especially paying attention at first to the education of women. Then she understood that my role is greater, not merely educating women, but India must be freed from the political bondage. So she joined the politics. Naturally, she had to separate from Ramakrishna Order. But she dedicated, she thought, this was what Swami Vivekananda wanted me really to do. So in brief, this is the life of Miss Margaret Noble, later on as a Brahmacharini, Sister Nivedita.
Thank you very much, Swamiji. Since I was also living with the monks of Sri Ramakrishna Mission, I saw that in the temple where, you know, you have do pujas to Sri Ramakrishna, there is a picture of Jesus Christ in Gethsemane, praying at the Gethsemane. And I was also told that every Christmas time, the monks will be washing your feet, each other. I don't know. I just want to hear about these two incidents, whether it is happening or what would be the reason.
No, I have not heard that. But we celebrate Eid, we celebrate Christmas, we celebrate the birthdays of Buddha, and what we believe, incarnations of God, and great souls like Shankaracharya, Ramanujacharya, etc. I have not heard this, but one of the direct disciples of Sri Ramakrishna, the first president of the Ramakrishna Order, called Swami Brahmanandaji, he had a vision of Christ. Sri Ramakrishna had a vision of Christ. Swamiji had a vision of Christ. Swami Brahmananji had a vision of Christ. And there is a peculiar belief in the Ramakrishna Order. Two disciples of Sri Ramakrishna, Swami Sharadanandaji and Swami Ramakrishnanandaji, both were in their past incarnation the disciples of Jesus Christ.
Thank you, Swamiji.
We have no problem. We can accept any number of incarnations. So that's why some Christian missionary said, I'm terribly frightened of Hinduism. It is like an octopus. It will simply absorb every incarnation of God and makes them one of the 3 crores of the God.
Swamiji, there is again a question in our chat box. It reads like this. Swamiji, thank you for the wonderful session. There is a saying, if you want to know India, study Swami Vivekananda.
Yes.
Can you give a brief explanation about it?
Yes. This was a saying of Mahatma Gandhi. Mahatma Gandhi once visited, even while Swamiji was alive at Belur Math, but gravely ill. Gandhiji could not see Swami Vivekananda because of his illness, but he left a message that Swami Vivekananda is India, India is Swami Vivekananda. If you want to understand true, I would say, Vedanta, by India he meant Vedanta, then you study Swami Vivekananda, because he is the embodiment of Vedanta. And again, I have to warn you, by Vedanta, we do not mean Hinduism. Hinduism is one manifestation of Vedanta. What is Vedanta? All of us are potentially divine. And life is given to us as a vehicle to manifest our divinity inevitably, helplessly. We are all standing on the escalator called spiritual evolutionary escalator. We may play about in the escalator, but ultimately the escalator helplessly will take us to our destination, which is to know that we are that same supreme reality. But Swami Vivekananda also was a great patriot. He loved India. He studied India many years. But then he came to the conclusion that Hinduism is great, India is great, there is spirituality. Religion is the backbone of India, but we have failed to understand our own heritage, and now we have to understand, and we have to become real human beings. And so he has given his rousing call, both for the secular welfare of India, and at the same time, for the revival of the spiritual potentiality of India. But I do not say only India. He was a universal man, Vishwa Manava Vivekananda. As I said, God doesn't incarnate only for one particular region, religion, or state. He is an embodiment of the whole world. But through India, because he was an Indian, he loved India. He wanted it to be politically free, intellectually free, free from all sorts of narrowness, dogmatism. That's why we will never find any narrowness, any constriction of ideas. He was as universal as Upanishads themselves. As you know, Upanishads never talk about anything else excepting the pure divinity of the soul. That's why Mahatma Gandhi said, if you want to understand India, true India, not the political India, not the sectarian ideas of India, but true India, Vedantic India, study Vivekananda, and you will not go wrong, and you will be a better, all the better person, all the way better for studying Swami Vivekananda.
Thank you very much, Swamiji. Swamiji, I have not a question, but a humble request. You see, yes. We are about to celebrate our Independence Day. Just a few days are there. Yeah. And what would be your message for our countrymen?
Yes.
When I ask you this, ask you or request you for this message,
yeah,
I was inspired. I am really inspired when you started about the contribution of Swami Vivekananda ji.
Yeah.
Now he said, like, you take the context of the 19th century,
yeah,
where he was able to gather not one or two, but then galvanize the entire entire population. With a unique teaching of humanism, I mean, with his background. So, what would be your message for our country as we are going to celebrate Independence Day? Thank you, Swamiji.
In a few brief sentences, if I understood Swami Vivekananda, my special message on this Independence Day would be, first of all, try to lead a righteous life. I cannot expect everybody to be completely unselfish. As one of our senior Swamis had put it, if you can reduce your selfishness by 10%, be 90% selfish, but 10% unselfish, many problems of India will be solved. So whatever work you are doing, do it sincerely. You are paid for that. Even if you are voluntary also, you did it voluntarily. Pay special attention. Do it with Shraddha. And always keep, I want to be happy. I want everybody else also to be happy. If we can maintain this attitude, then truly our India is having tremendous potentiality. The greatest contributions of India is from the mathematics to the sciences, great physical discoveries of modern science are already hinted at the unity of the whole world, but with much greater vision and depth. So again, to put it, let us be at least 10% unselfish, and not only our happiness, let us try to contribute to the happiness, development of everybody. And if we can do our duty properly, that would be true celebration of independence.
Thank you very much, Swamiji, for those insightful words. Not words, but insightful sentences that are really appropriate for all of us, for our country. And thank you very much, all of you. I don't see any more comments or any other observations. Just to say our concluding words, Swamiji, it was just like watching a beautiful movie or somebody telling us about a saint of our country with so much of conviction, and not somebody saying about somebody, but somebody who lives the life of Swami Vivekananda. And that I could feel when you presented about Swami Vivekananda, and also in your interactions. Thank you very much, Swamiji. It was a great privilege for me and for all of us to hear from you. And then lastly, that practical suggestion. Okay, only 10% you give out your selfishness. Or I mean, that is actually way forward that we cannot. Thank you very much. And I must thank also ECC and Father Matthew, Father S. Kumar, and all of you for organizing these seminars continuously, not simply once in a while, but connecting our people, connecting the country, connecting the rich traditions of our country to so many people. Thank you very much. And over to Shiva Kumar or to Father Matthew.
Thank you very much, Swamiji, for this erudite and soul-stirring lecture on Swami Vivekananda, and also to Father Tom. Though you said you don't want to moderate Swamiji, but I think that it was a wonderful combination of, you know, the experiences sharing, and also you are from the Northeast as you are working there, so connecting the whole of India. Thank you, Father Tom. And also for all of you who are all present here, we have people from all over the world. I see my friend Daniel Goody from Scotland, and people from even other countries, and also all of our friends from India. So this will be the question for those who do the certificate course. Illustrate how Swami Vivekananda reformed Hinduism through Neo-Vedanta and connected it with the whole universal brotherhood. So that will be the question, and it will be given in the our WhatsApp group. And also Minlun or Sukumar, the next Thursday, the lecture?
Yeah, the next lecture is on Basaveswara by Professor Dr. Ashok Allur, next Thursday, 16th August.
Yeah, Basaveswara is again another great saint from the 12th century of Karnataka. So he was the one, the founder of Lingayat or Veerashaiva. So all of you are most welcome to participate. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Great.